with great reverence, I greet you all. Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa la sharika lahu. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa rasulillahi kareem wa ala aswajihi alihi wa sabihi wa duriyatihi ismaeen. I greet you all with the greeting a faith, assalamu alaikum. We thank Allah. We thank Allah the Most High for blessing us with another opportunity to come together, following the tradition of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to congregate. To hear someone address faith from the perspective of the Quran al-Kareem, and from the life and the sirah and the uswa of Muhammad, prayers and peace be upon him, and from his companions, because the companions of the Prophet, prayers and peace be upon him, were an extension of him. And he couldn't be every place, and so he sent people in his stead with the confidence that they would not disappoint him in representing his office. Now we know, most of you who are, I would dare to say all of you who are here in my presence right now are adults. None of you are babies. But I would also say with a degree of confidence that all of you started out as children, and you grew. And we know that growth is the natural order of life. We grow, the plants are growing now in the spring, and many of the animals have gave birth in the late winter or giving birth. We know that many of the birds now are looking around our homes, our habitations. They're looking for some place that we haven't secured so they can go in and start a nest. It may be in the trees, it may be in the eaves, but somewhere they're looking for a place where they can have growth. And we know that it's a tradition that even though the day begins with Maghrib, with the sunset, the tradition is that the first prayer is Fajr prayer. And we know that from Fajr prayer on up to Dhuhr prayer or Asr prayer, that the light is growing from the dawn, from the Falak, from all the way to the Shuruq, to the Duha, to Dhuhr, into the Asr when the sun begins to decline. And those are important things, signs from Allah. As the light advances, so does the human intellect. And one of the things that has advanced in the human being for us that we want to have some thoughts about today is our understanding of the divine reality. So what is the divine reality? We say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the divine reality. Allah the Most High, the Most Glorious and the Most High. But we know that the human being did not start out with an awareness of Allah. That the human being start out with worshiping his shadow. He started out worshiping the ground, worshiping mountains, worshiping waters, worshiping the sun, worshiping the moon, worshiping the stars. And that Allah, the Most High, has revealed to us that we, though we have advanced much in the 21st century, that the knowledge of him is very limited, and that he says in the Ayat al-Qudsi that he knows what happened before we were born. He knows what's going to happen after we pass away. But of his knowledge, we only have what he has provided to us, given to us. We have no independent source of knowledge except what Allah has blessed us with out of his mercy. And so as we have come to understand Allah, we know that there are times in history, and it's not that far off, when we worship the male idea, the idea of masculinity as the God. And there were times, sometimes in the same time, when people worship goddesses like Venus and Aphrodite and Minerva. And so we had these male gods and these female gods. And so we were, at that time, our understanding of Allah was in its infancy. Because we were seeing Allah in the mirror. We're worshiping the male, but where do we find the male? The male is in us. Where do we find the female? The female is in us. And so we were looking at ourselves, and we were seeing Allah as being a counterpart to what we saw in ourselves. Or maybe we were worshiping the dog or the cat or the beetle or the alligator. All these different things what we found in worship, but they were worshiped in time. But just as you have grown into adults, that you're sitting here, you know, none of you are wearing diapers, perhaps. Or none of you are in the cribs. None of you crawled in here. But you advance yourself over that stage. And we have, as a body politic, as a human family, we have advanced ourselves in the understanding of the Godhead, of the divine reality. And then Allah, he revealed to us Al-Fatiha. He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He says, Allah, he is the source of those things that you say are masculine. He's a Rahman, not you. It is him. He's the one who's the nurturer. He's the one who's the one who is forgiving and is forbearing. Not the wife, not the mother. That's him. And he is the boss, not Donald Trump. He's Maliki Yawmiddin. He has the final say in all things. So what Allah is telling us in this Al-Fatiha, which is the key to understanding religious scripture, those seven verses unlocks the concepts in religion. And one of the concepts we have to say, yeah, you got to stop looking for the Trinity. You see, they know that we are confused about Allah. So what they do is they give you three of them. And you can pick the one you want. You want God the Father? You want the power figure? Well, you could have, you know, you could look at the football players or the hockey players or the Pele, who plays the real football, right? Soccer. Or you could say the real power, the one who has the real might, is Allah the Most High. He's the powerful. Excuse me. That could be Donald Trump. He may not agree with me, but I say Allah is God and not him. That's right, Donald. Please, everybody, please turn your phones to silent or whatever. And I apologize. So, when we are looking at when Allah revealed Himself to the Prophet, praise and peace be upon him, for the first time, He didn't reveal Himself as Allah. He said, "Read in the name of the Rabb." And so, it wasn't time for him to give him all his information. So he started off and read in the name of really the Mother Nature, who has advanced us to the point where we can stand on two feet and make progress as the Homo erectus, not as the animal, not crawling, but standing up with a settled, mature mind. And then we can present it with Allah. And Allah says, "You can't see me. Tell them that I'm one. That I'm eternal. That I never grow up. And I never get old. And there's nothing that can be presented as my metaphor. You have nothing. There's nothing you can point to in the heavens and the earth and say, this is what Allah is like." And so if we're conceiving Allah correctly, when we are dreaming and we're thinking about Allah, you should really see nothing. Because anything you see is a gross insult to the majesty of Allah, to picture, like in the movies, they had that Morgan Freeman. And sometimes they had the guy who smoked the small cigars, George Burns. They show him as Allah, but that's, again, Allah's bigger than that. He don't have no gray hair. He's not getting old. His back ain't hurting. So, who turned that light on? You so good, man. Go ahead. Look, see now, and then what is that? See, Allah was sent the angels to do that. We're trying to get some light in here. The man came in and said, "These brothers are in the dark." and these sisters. What they're trying to do, they need to understand the reality of Allah. Why would you see Allah as a baby? Why? Because they're trying to bring that nature in you and make you a baby. So they present the God as a baby, born in Bethlehem, born in filth, in the manger. You know the manger's not clean. Imagine where they feed the animals. They're slobbering in there. There's maggots in there. Why? Because the food is sitting there all day long. The flies are on those food. The food starts rotting. The maggots are there. So they're saying that, look, this thing here that you're looking at is not all that important, not that big. Then they bring it up and they show Jesus as a man. But they don't show him as a masculine man. He's very effeminate. But he's not the only one. In addition to the effeminate man, they didn't bring the Father, who's up there saying, "Well, look, I'm gonna let him handle it. But if you all mess with him, I'm coming with the fire." And then they have this other one who you really can't get your hands on. He's the Holy Ghost.
So they give you three. Why are they doing this? Because you are confused. You're trying to see Allah in your reality. And so if they give you one, it's not going to be enough. If they give you the masculine God, well, you're going to find a fault with him. Oh, he's too hard. He's too rough. They give you the female God. Oh, she's too much of a sissy. And they give you the baby God. And that brings out the baby nature in you. So you remain retarded, stunted in your spiritual growth. So this is how we have come along in society, bringing these concepts. And then finally, it gets to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah says, I'm the Rab. I'm the Maliki Nas. I'm Ilahi Nas. I'm Rahman. I'm powerful. I'm masculine. I'm Rahim. I'm feminine. Those attributes are not you. That's me. When you act like that, you're trying to emulate my characteristics. But I go beyond the heavens. I go beyond the earth. Nothing escapes me. Time is something on you. The time has no relevance to Allah. He's in the past. He's in the future. He's in the present. And so we are going on this trajectory of divine growth and understanding, and we're arriving and arriving. And as we grow, we become a better society because we see the delineation between the divine reality, which is Allah the Most High, and the human plane, which is far below that. But we're moving towards a better, as they say, a more perfect union. And so that's the point of Juma, is that we want to get some light here. So we want to get nearer to the pleasure, that we want to be that homo erectus that Allah the Most High is pleased with and is accepting of. But to do that, we have to never mix the idea of what is divine with what is humane and what is human. And we have to keep those levels separate and apart, dear believers. But we are so thankful that we are not have a confused state, that we don't know how to see Allah. Allah is that which is at the ultimate destiny for the human intellect, for the human emotion, and for the human physical presence. And we leave this planet, which one day we will, we believe. Wherever we go, we're moving still on the destiny to meet Allah the Most High. And this is a great blessing to have a body of knowledge in this Quran that presents Allah for the first time in humanity in the correct constitution, to see that he is not physical, but he is qualitative. He's one. Well, one is a concept. Because in that oneness, you see many facets. That he's eternal. And the concept of eternity is really a difficult thing for us to really wrap our minds around in a complete way. Because there's nothing that we have experienced that is eternal in this life. Because everything in this life starts off with a beginning. And so we are so thankful to be able to go to this Quran and look at Al-Fatiha and get for the first time the description of Allah, so we don't have to be burdened with trying to be God. That's what big burden on the white man, to be God. In fact, he has to make excuses. Oh, that's poor white trash. Those people here picking their nose with their feet up there. No, that's not really white people. That's the stuff we threw away. Well, he has to say that. Why? Because to keep his great image up, he can't have any imperfection. And then why are you going to the beach to get a tan? So all these are burdens on them. And then the black man, the owner, the maker, cream of the planet Earth, the God of the universe, who works as an elevator operator at Winthrop and Lothrop. So that's a big burden. You the black God, and then you go, the man come to the door, knock on the door, police, open up. Stand against the wall. How are you going to put the God against the wall? Huh? So that's a big burden. You're telling your son you're God, and then this man here, who's half your size, half your weight, tell you to stand up and put your hands behind your back. Isn't that a burden on you? That's a big burden. So with Allah, when we see Allah correctly in this Quran, then we have to say, Allah ain't no baby. He ain't no baby in the manger. How are you worshiping your child who you are nursing? So we can't do that. We have to see Allah. And no disrespect to the Christians. They are given the information at their stage. But there's going to come a time when they're going to say, we have to see Christ as the model human. Not as the model God. Because if you would just take some time to read what Jesus said. He says, can the one who was sent be equal to his sender? And he says in this Bible, in this language, and I accept this language, because we already know that Allah is God. He's the Father and he's the Mother. So he says, my Father is greater than I. And so God is my Father and my Mother is greater than I and you all put together, whoever lived. So if you look at his language, he is teaching, but we are all students. And right now, we have to accept them, because in sincerity, their perception is held with sincerity. And in sincerity, let's move into that topic. Yeah, I think we've done this topic on seeing Allah as Allah has presented himself in the Quran and in the teachings, in the tafsir of Muhammad the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But next thing we want to talk about, because we hear the approaching, like a gentle breeze of the coming of the holy month of Ramadan. But Ramadan is something that Allah says in this Quran that we are to enter the religion. He says, but he who brings the truth and he who wholeheartedly accepts it as true, it is they who are truly conscious of God. So if we're going to have a successful Ramadan, the focus is not all so much on the fasting. What are we talking about? It's not on the fast. Of course it's on the fast. No! It's on the sincerity of the believer. Because your fast may not be my fast. Now you look at the Ramadan, you can't eat and you can't drink. And you make your extra prayers. But compare yourself. You going home this Ramadan to an air-conditioned house. You got an automobile. You taking all your multivitamins at night. And compare yourself to the companions of the Prophet who lived in the desert, 125 degrees, and didn't even have a thermostat. Did they? Why didn't they have thermostat? Because they didn't have a doggone air conditioner. They had maybe a little fan, someone could blow it on them, or they could run some water or something. But so when it comes to fasting, we have a very light circumstance. We got a clock telling us to get up to make the suhoor. It's iftar coming right now. This is how many people didn't know? They inside, they don't know what time the sun was setting. They're doing things. They may be in these places, they may not have windows where they live. I don't think they had glass there. I think they had glass, but it was very limited, and these were very poor people. So the fasting that we're doing is not as difficult, but the enticements out here are so much more numerous. I mean, you're down there at the MGM Grand on Ramadan, and you want to gamble because you know that next one might be the one that's the 777. But let me try this dollar in there. Who knows? That could be it, and then I could help them fix that sign at the masjid that's all tatted. So that's a very difficult thing. But so the difficulty now is, can you maintain the discipline of Ramadan in this world of what's that called? Lycra? that the women are wearing now? See, they're wearing Batgirl's costume now. They got Batwoman's costume wearing it to court. The judge will tell you they're coming to court in spandex and nothing else on, top and bottom. So are you looking for, you expect them to turn to the Invisible Girl or something? I guess that's what happens when they step you back. Now, in this world, when you have all these different things, in this society, what we need is to maintain our sincerity to Allah and maintain the discipline of behavior. It's not just the food. What's more important than not having the food for those of us who are diabetic, those of us who are ill, those of us in doctor care, you can still have a perfect Ramadan even though you have to eat, because you have to maintain the discipline of your conduct. You got to stop gossiping. You have to stop being angry at it all the time. You have to increase your charity. If you can't fast from food, then fast from other things. Fast from your nasty attitude. Give away some food. Do some extra work. Now, I want to suggest that we raise for our building fund during this holy month $10,000. So we're asking 20 people can pay $500. Well, you're going to save that because you're not going to the movies. You're not eating. You're giving up all these ice cream. You're giving up all these other pleasures. And so you're going to save $500. So if we have 20 people or 40 people with $250, then we can put another $10,000 towards our building fund. And so this is the goal. Because we have air conditioning. We're not going to give that back. That's a blessing from Allah. We're going to keep it. So let's go further than just being hungry. Let's make a financial sacrifice to advance the cause of bringing the information. We want to bring this Quran to people. There were some travelers last week. We were having our fish fry. And the brothers came up there and they looked up and they saw the sign, the Ali Khan Islamic Center. And they were from North Carolina. They said, wow, there's a place to pray. And they came in here and made salah. But our sign now is coming down. We have to have a beacon in the darkness to let people know that there's a place to pray. There's a sanctuary. There's a place where you can come and be with the believers. So let us increase our concept of what is the Ramadan. What is Allah asking of? He's asking that we restrain ourselves. That we call ourselves back from the brink of the hellfire. And to do that is not just food. Because food is difficult but easy compared to the companions when this was revealed. And Allah was so gracious to them. Because when Ramadan was first revealed, they had the iftar, but they didn't have the suhoor. So the believers, they had one meal and they were fasting the whole time. And what was happening is that the Muslims were fainting. Now, don't forget the fact that they also went to Badr during Ramadan and had to fight the Quraysh. But Allah then revealed that he said, eat if you want all night until the dawn. But this was not the initial revelation of the holy month. So Allah says, and then he said, I saw what you were doing. Because when they first revealed Ramadan, there was no sex for the whole month. Now, some of you said that's a blessing. But most of us probably say that's a difficulty. That's another fact. But Allah says, then he revealed, lawful to you access to your wives during the night. That came later. But he also added something, you know, almost like a you know, what you might call a little footnote. He says, but I knew what you were doing. Did you see that in the Quran? He said, he's aware of what you were doing. You were having sex anyway. Now, he didn't say, are you all going to hell? Why? Because unlike us, Allah is very magnanimous. He put that on it and made it real difficult. And then he gave them a break. And they seemed like Ramadan became easy to them. And so that was of great mercy. First, he made it a situation that was very difficult on the believers. And then he gave them a great dispensation. And they said, wow, we can do this. Now, for us, we say Ramadan's hard, period. But imagine, no access to your wife and no food after your first meal. You go to bed and you just, and if you lay down and miss the one meal, you would have to fast for two straight days in the desert. And it was very difficult. But what was Allah testing in them? Their commitment and their sincerity. And this is what we want to ask. Don't be so hung up on the food. Some of you can't fast because you're ill. Don't listen. When Allah says that you have to be well and you have to be sane, then accept that. Do not force this issue because Allah is in charge of what this is. Don't you try to bring your own Ramadan rules in. Allah says if you are ill, then take your medication. It doesn't break the fast because the fast is your discipline, is your self-restraint. You getting that look. And I don't have time to argue with you. Now, the other thing we want to talk about, dear believers, what's our time like? Okay. Allah says, "O you," this is in Surah 66, verse 8. "O you who believe, turn to Allah a sincere turning. Maybe your Lord will remove from you your evil and cause you to enter gardens beneath which rivers flow. On the day on which Allah will not abase the Prophet and those who believe with him, their light shall run on before them, and on their right hands they will say." Their light will run before them and be on their right hands. And they will say, "Our Lord, make perfect for us our light and grant us protection. Surely you have the power over all things." So Allah is telling us that if we're going to come to Islam, don't come half-heartedly. Don't have one foot in belief in God and one foot saying, well, how do I know? Maybe the Satan worshipers have a point there. So I might believe a little bit in the devil worship and I believe, I see some good points. Come 100%. And we don't have to give up Jesus. Jesus was a Muslim. And his mother Mary. They were believers. 100%. So we're comfortable with the Christians because we love whom they love and we have equal love. Now our understanding is different because we have been invited to the science of Quran, which breaks us out of the three and brings us to the one that Allah never was a baby. We have to reject that. But he has the masculine quality. He has the feminine quality. He has the might. He has the wisdom. All those things that we value in ourselves. Allah is the best possessor of those qualities that we strive to attain and emulate. And so we want to be sincere to come into this wholeheartedly. And then what happens? Allah says he's going to give us a light. And that light is going to make Ramadan so much easier. And Ramadan is the purpose of Ramadan. And I know that some believers may disagree with me, but the purpose of Ramadan is not to suffer. It's that we can attain consciousness and nearness to Allah. And that might not be for you. You may be someone who hates food. So fasting is really something you do all the time. But it is the restraint and the consciousness and the sincerity and the becoming more charitable, becoming more kind. Trying to speak to Allah more often. Read some more Quran. And they say, Imam Al-Ghazali, during Ramadan, he read the entire Quran twice a day. Twice a day he read the Quran. So, if you read it twice a day, Ramadan, read it four times a day. Because you want to show an increase. You want to show, in this month, that you are on your training. What are you training? Your stomach? No. We are training our heart to be a better human being. And the law says that he has given this idea of sacrifice to every community. Has this idea of sacrifice. Now, some people, they got it wrong and they were cutting off people's heads to sacrifice them to their gods. Allah says sacrifice the negative implications in your life. And come in sincerely to Allah so that he may what? Give us a light. And what is the objective in the end? Isn't the objective the night of power? Laylatul Qadr. And what are we trying to get in Laylatul Qadr? We're trying to get the Holy Spirit. Alhamdulillah.
Nastainahu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi azza wa jal. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa dahu la sharika lahu. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa salatu wa salamu ala Muhammad Rasulullah Kareem. I greet you again. Assalamu alaikum. Well, we thank Allah the Most High for blessing us to get this close. We're about, I think, about 2 weeks away from the start of Ramadan. So we need to get ready, dear believers. We're going to need, I think, Imam John Bilal told me we need about 250 or 350 to replace that sign. Have you all seen the sign outside the masjid? How tattered it is? Before you leave here, we're going to ask you to make an extra donation. We need to be, when Ramadan comes, we want to have that sign replaced at the beginning so that the Christians know that, you know, they had their Easter, we got our Ramadan. They had Lent, we're going to have Ramadan, but we're going to fix this place up. We want to clean this place up. We want to get some dates in here, some water in here. We want to replace that sign. And I'm asking the believers, don't wait till Eid al-Fitr to pay your Sadaqah Fitr. We need to give this money out before. So the people here who are poor, they can come out and enjoy the Eid. But if we give it to them the day after Eid, that's backwards. So at the beginning of Ramadan, try to pay your Sadaqah. Because we need these funds, because we have people in here who are suffering. People who can't pay their rent. People who can't feed their children. People who want to have something nice to wear for the Eid. And we know that this year, we're coming up on the 40th anniversary of the first Hajj, from the first significant delegation from the United States, 1977, when Imam W. Muhammad, may Allah be pleased with him and grant him freedom for his sins and grant him a high place in paradise. He's brought 300 believers from the United States to let the rest of the world know that the sun has risen in the west. So this is 40-year anniversary, and there's some people, I think, in this audience who went on that trip. And so, inshallah, maybe we can't go back this year. I think they're planning it, but I would hope they plan it for at least 2 years to give everybody a chance so we could bring 5,000. 40 years later, we shouldn't bring 400. We should bring 5,000 to commemorate this community who the world had thrown away. Ain't nothing in worse than a nigger. They had thrown us away to nothing. And Allah himself, he raised us up. Now, you would say, after the Nation of Islam, it would be impossible to establish Islam among the blacks. They were so confused. They worshiping Master Farad, calling the black man God, calling the black woman the Muslim girl. How could they say they will never get this religion? And just, you know, look, all our lives we were saying, I hope they one day see a black president. We woke up one morning, he was in the White House.
eating watermelon. What? And did anybody bomb the White House and said, no. It took us longer to adjust to old Black Obama than the Caucasians. They accepted him out of the way. Why? He had gone to Harvard. He was the president of the moot court, the law review. And there wasn't nobody more qualified than him who ran. John McCain, he was embarrassed to have to debate. In fact, one day he said he was going back to D.C. to vote rather than debate Obama. Y'all remember that? He didn't want to debate him because Obama was clearly the best man, the best mind, the best human. Barack Hussein was the best one for the job. And they accepted that. So I'm waiting for the day when they say Islam is the true religion so we can stop hiding the fact that our middle name is Muhammad. What's your name? John H. Jones. Don't tell him you're Muhammad. You sitting next to them. I know Muslims that telling me, calling me up, said, "How would you represent me? I won this jackpot," and they didn't get Muslims want me to sue the horseshoe. I want the tape to see where my number came up, and they didn't certify it. So, well, that's okay, because you know something? Allah is not petty. You think someone's going, this is off the subject a little bit, but I'm going to go here. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you think someone's going to hell because they drank liquor? That's stupid. Every time you alcohol is in everything. It's in mouthwash. Now, you can get some mouthwash without alcohol, but, alcohol is a lot of places. Now, am I advocating alcohol? I don't drink. I don't advocate alcohol, but I want you to be sober. Stop looking at people because they ate some pig. Yeah, you say, this man really done gone crazy. No, the pig is really talking about something beyond that animal's flesh. Now, am I advocating eating hog mug and hog head cheese? Man, I would throw up. That's a real torture. Bring someone and say, look, you got to eat this or tell us where they hid the bomb. All right. No, you don't need to waterboard me. All right. So, Allah is bigger than this, but these are things that are helping us become nearer to Him. And at that time, the pig was deadly. Now, nowadays, the beef is just a little better than the pig. Now, we don't eat the pig, but back then, many of these things were on the physical level. Now it's more so on the spiritual level. So your relatives, you have to say to yourself, how come now my cousin, he's a deacon in the church, he eats pig, he smokes, he drinks, he's doing all these different things, yet he seems to be happy. His children all got straight A's. They all got went to the best schools. How Allah is blessing him? Because Allah's not looking at that. He's looking at what is his nature. How does he treat you? How does he treat his family? Does he call on Allah or Jesus in the middle of the night with sincerity? You're looking at these little things. He don't wear a kufi. But why would a Christian be wearing a kufi? He don't wear a kufi. He don't wear a jalabiyah. Well, that ain't no big deal. If the Prophet Muhammad was in America, he wouldn't be wearing no kufi or jalabiyah. That's not the big thing. In fact, the jalabiyah was being worn by Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. You all know who those people are? They're one of the two people that have a surah named after them. Abu Lahab. He got a surah named after him. What do you translate? What does it mean, Abu Lahab? The father of hell. He's the uncle of the prophet. And he had a jalabiyah. Someone, Imam Yahya told me that. He says, man, the clothes you trying to promote, they was being worn by the what do you call the people? The kufar. The Prophet Muhammad wasn't the only one with jalabiyah. All the people that were trying to kill him had them on. So that ain't no divine clothing. That was the clothing of the when I go to Arabia, I wear jalabiyah. They're cheap. They're nice. I blend in. I try to get a better price at the those rugs made in China where you can buy them pair of rugs you bring back here. So we almost time to. But listen, we're gonna have this weekend is the International Business Symposium in Raleigh, North Carolina. I urge you to go there and support the Muslims who are doing international business. What's the most important international business? Hajj. But, you know, listen, we go to Dubai, let's make some money. We also have the brothers meeting here Saturday from 10 to noon. We have the Talim in the Arabic from 11 to is it 10 to 12. We have karate here. What day is it? Is it Monday, Thursday, and Saturday? Okay, Monday, Thursday, and Saturday we have karate, and it's the children are primary there, but we'll take the adults. We have a fish fry here periodically. We're gonna have a flea market win soon. We're gonna have a flea market soon, so all those things your wife told you to throw away, bring them to us, and we can sell them. We asked Imam, we asked Judge LME, maybe he could bring his Corvette. He said he can sell that. I'll buy it for the right price. I might even buy one of them big bikes you got. So we thank Allah for blessing us with you all. We pray that Allah the Most High. Let's make a dua. Oh Allah the Most High, we ask that you bless us to come into Ramadan wholeheartedly, that make us people of faith. And we ask Allah that you bless this community. Bless this mighty country. Bless our brothers and sisters in the Islam and Christian faith and the Jewish faith and all people who are trusting in you. And those who don't know you or who have rejected you, we ask that you open up their hearts so that they can come into faith so we can move closer to the society that's pleasing to you. Ameen. Akim Esalah. Someone give me a hand with this. Push this back. Grab it by the bottom. Grab it by the bottom.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Yeah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Shahadu la ilaha illallah. Shahadu la ilaha
illallah. Give him a spot. Make sure he has a spot. In the front.
Ashhadu anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah. Hayya al-Salah. Hayya al-Salah. Hayya al-Falah. Hayya al-Falah. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
Make sure straighten out your lines, letting the blue come up a little bit. Make sure you're straight. You all should be focusing on this brother right here, and move out on both directions. Estau. Let us give our intention to make Esalatu Juma. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladina an'amta 'alayhim. غير مغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. اقرا بسم الله خلق خلق الانسان من علق اقرا ربك الاكرم الذي علم بالكلم علم الانسان محل يحلم. الله اكبر. Allahu liman hamida. Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar. Allahu Akbar. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim Malik Yawm al-Din. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladina an'amta 'alayhim. Ghayru maghdubi 'alayhim waladdallin. Qul huwallahu ahad. Allahu samad. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. Lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Allahu akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Al-Fatiha together. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Malik yawm al-din. Ya na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alayhim. Allahumma anta as-salamu minka wa tarak wa tadri ali wa akram. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim fi al-alamin innaka Hamidum Majid. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Takbir. Takbir.
Takbir.
Takbir.
Allahu Akbar. Thank you all. Don't forget the
Allahu Akbar. Sadaqa.
We gotta replace our sign. Please give generously. Alhamdulillah, mashallah.
May I ask, do we have any brothers or sisters that have made a commitment to going to Hajj? Because if we know you're going, we want to make a dua for all our possible Hajjis.
Yes, sir.
So please let us know loud and clear.
Well, if they go in the 40, I'm gonna be in
the trip. Assalamu alaikum. I just want to take a few minutes of your time to tell you about our big fundraiser for this year. This year we're going to Louisville, Kentucky, to the Ali Khan. I'm sorry, Muhammad Ali Center. It's a
listen up, folks.
It's a 3-day affair. You will be getting details very soon. So if we do not have your email or any information on you, please see us so that we can keep you informed. And we want to set up something so that you can pay your money a little bit at a time. Or if you have it, you can pay all at once. But we're going to have a very nice bus. We will be leaving on a Thursday, inshallah, and coming back on a Sunday. It's being planned out. We're having Baltimore is participating with us. Masjid Muhammad, the nation's capital, Masjid is participating with us. And if we can get at least 8 people to commit from each one of those, then we will have done what we expect to do to make money on this. And we'll give you the breakdown and everything very soon on what's going on. But it's going to be a trip that you won't want to miss. So please make sure we have your accurate information and you can start paying your money as soon as you feel like you have extra so that you'll be ready to go on time.
What's the complete price of the trip?
We're not sure yet, but we do know that the bus is going to be $150, I believe. And if you were going by plane, you're going to pay at least $300, at least.
What's in Louisville, Kentucky?
The Muhammad Ali Center. And we'll be able to see, you know, where his burial site and all of that. Plus, there are other things that we'll be seeing. You know, there will be a jazz show at night and all the different scenes in Louisville. All right, that's it. Thank you. I assume like.